Hello, my name is Olivia Mattis, and I'm delighted to welcome you to today's program on behalf of the Sousa Mendes Foundation. We have a very big crowd with us today, and that is absolutely delightful. Some of you are new, so let me tell you briefly about our foundation. The Sousa Mendes Foundation was started 11 years ago in 2010 to celebrate a hero named Aristides de Sousa Mendes, who saved thousands of lives during World War II. And this past year, every Sunday, we've been holding programs on other heroes and beautiful stories of rescue and resistance. And today is one such breathtaking story. We have a moderator during today's program who will introduce today's panel. So let me turn the floor over to the moderator. It's Dr. Shulamit Reinhartz. She is a professor emerita at Brandeis University. She's a sociologist and an expert on women's history. And Shulamit, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. And thank you for the privilege of hosting with you this meeting today and moderating it. It is my pleasure now to introduce our two participants. I will start with the Sheikh. If you look at the third person on your gallery, you will see a man whose name actually has five different parts. It is Sheikh Ul Mashaikh Mahmoud Khan Yoskin. Would you all say that with me? No, I'm just kidding. And I asked him how he would like to be referred to, and he said Mahmoud Khan, which I'm sure we can all understand. Mahmoud Khan is the son of an Indian father and a Dutch mother. He lived in The Hague in Holland his entire life. In fact, in the same house. The Sheikh is the nephew of the founder of the Sufi movement, Hazrat Inayat Khan. And he is an expert, although a very modest man, on the Middle East and India. His father and Noor's father were brothers. That is why he is a cousin of the World War II British secret agent, Noor Inayat Khan, and knew her personally. Thank you for joining us, Sheikh. And now I would like to introduce you to our main speaker. And her name is SHRABANI BASU, only two words. She was born in Kolkata and grew up in Dhaka, in Kathmandu and Delhi. She studied history at St. Stephen's College in Delhi and gained a master's degree there. SHRABANI is a British Indian journalist and historian. She is the author of several books, and she authored Spy Princess, The Life of Noor Inayat Khan, which some of you have read, and I have learned that there are just 15 copies left in under Olivia's control, and she will gladly send them to you. And after she, SHRABANI published the book, The Spy Princess, she discovered that there was a lot of interest. And so she founded the Noor Inayat Khan Memorial Trust, which had several goals, one of which is to create a memorial to Noor Inayat Khan in the center of London. And there are about five different things that the trust accomplished. I want to just end her introduction by saying that she is the author of Victoria and Abdul, which many of you have seen probably, a full-length feature film when we used to go to the movies. And the subtitle is The True Story of the Queen's Closest Confidant, published in 2010. And she has published many other things beyond that. Let's start with SHRABANI, who will tell us the story of her book and the story of Noor Inayat Khan's life.
Thank you, Shula. Thank you for that lovely introduction. And thank you, Olivia, for inviting me. It's a pleasure and a privilege to be here to talk about our World War II heroine, Noor Inayat Khan. So let's dive straight in. On the 13th of September, 1944, a beautiful Indian woman lay dead on the floor of a prison concentration camp in Dachau. The Germans knew her only as a British spy, Nora Ray Baker, but her real name was Noor Inayat Khan, and she was descended from a famous Indian ruler in South India. So how did this genteel, beautiful woman land up on the floor of this bleak concentration camp? Let's follow her story from India to Europe. So we'll start with her father, Hazrat Inayat Khan. Now he was a Sufi, a musician, and I'll just briefly explain what Sufism is. Sufism is a branch of Islam which believes in music and meditation. And Hazrat Inayat Khan was told by his teacher to take Sufism to the West. So he took his brothers. So one of the brothers is Mahmud's father, and they all go to the US where they tour, they do concerts. And on one of these concerts, he meets this beautiful woman, Ora Ray Baker, and they fall in love. They go to UK, they go to London, they get married there, they start a life there. And then Hazrat Inayat Khan gets an invitation from Moscow to play at a concert. So the family moved to Moscow, and it's in Moscow that Noor is born. She's called Babuli by her father. Babuli means my daughter, precious daughter. And her real full name, of course, is Pirzadi Noorunnisa Inayat Khan. But there's trouble in Moscow at this time, so the family have to move. Once again, they move to London, and they live in this place called Gordon Square. And here, three more children are born. So the eldest son is, after Noor, is Vilayat, and then we have Hidayat, and then we have baby Claire. And Noor is very proud of all her siblings. She mothers them all, and you can see her very happy. But now the family move again. They move to France 6 years later, and they settle in this beautiful house called Fazl Manzil, which means house of blessing. And it is in this house that Noor is going to grow up. So this is central to her life in France. It is in Suresnes, in the outskirts of Paris. From the steps, the lights of Paris are visible. The children sit on the steps and they look out, they wear their Indian clothes, they look out over the lights of Paris. You can see them all, you know, playing their dressing up games. And it's a house full of music and meditation. But tragedy is to come, you know, hit this family very quickly, because when Noor is just 12, her father goes to India because he's missing India and he hasn't returned for so long. He goes to India, but he unfortunately dies there. And so suddenly this family is devastated. Her mother just goes upstairs and doesn't want to come out. She's depressed. And Noor has to take control and become mother to all her siblings and look after them. But the house remains. The uncles are there. It remains a place, center of music, meditation. All the children are musicians. Noor learns to play the harp. Her sister Claire plays the piano. And Vilayat plays the cello. Hidayat plays the violin. They form a quartet. And they all give their concerts in Fazl Manzil. Noor also wants to learn her father's instrument, which is the veena, which you saw her father playing. And she is here playing this again. She now, as a young adult, she goes to the Sorbonne. She learns child psychology there. And she also goes to the music school, École Normale, where she studies the harp and composition. And here she falls in love. She falls in love with a Jewish musician, but the family sort of object to it because he's a bit domineering and they feel he's, you know, he's domineering Noor. So she's torn between her love for, you know, her Jewish, she's engaged to him though, defying her family and her family. And so she writes a lot of poetry at this time. She's also finding her life, her feet as a writer of children's stories. So some of these are being published in the newspapers. And she now starts writing her book. This is when she's on holiday in Holland. And she writes her first book, 20 Jataka Tales. This is published in UK and it's published in 1939. And so we know what happens in 1939. War clouds are gathering in Europe. So this, you know, squashing all the ambitions of this budding writer of children's stories. Now in 1940, when the German army, excuse me, is poised outside the gates of Paris, the siblings meet. So Noor and Vilayat meet, they sit in the Oriental Room and they have a really serious discussion. They say, we are Sufis, we believe in nonviolence, but it's not right to stand by and watch. They can see what's happening to the Jews. They feel it's important to fight fascism. So they leave for, they say that we're going to leave for London. So the decision is taken, they go to London. In a bombed out London, Vilayat volunteers for the RAF. And Noor says that she just follows her brother. She says she's going to volunteer for the Women's Auxiliary Air Force. And here she is in her uniform. She loved this uniform. And suddenly she's just a number. She's aircraft's woman with a number, a far cry from the genteel life that she lived, surrounded by her uncles, her brothers, very protected, music, meditation. Suddenly she's just out there and she actually feels really free. She feels that she's got a purpose in her life. She makes lots of friends. And she is now being trained very crucially as a radio operator. The first batch of women radio operators to be trained in this field. And while she's practicing her Morse code, she's doing very well at it. Noor is being watched by a secret organization called the Special Operations Executive. And they are looking out for people with language skills. So Noor fits the bill perfectly because she's fluent in French. She knows the area well. She's also a very skilled radio operator. And that is what they need because radio operators were dropping like flies in Europe. All the men, their life expectancy was 6 weeks. So they needed trained radio operators. So Noor is called for an interview. She goes for this interview and it's in a room where somebody meets, she's opposite this man who talks to her in French. And he says a very few things. He says, you'll be sent undercover to Europe, to France. You won't be in uniform. And if you're caught, you will be shot. Will you take the job? And Noor says, yes. So this is the beginning of her secret life. She now has to be trained as a secret agent. So in a series of country houses scattered over England, Noor's training begins. This is now her clandestine life. She's given a code name. Her code name is Madeleine. She practices her signature. She's taught a lot of, all the things that secret agents need to be taught. She's taught apart from her Morse code, how to recruit a source, how to break locks, how to dead letter boxes, where to leave messages, live letter boxes, how to contact a source, and various, all the training. And all this happens, firearms training, which she hates because she's a pacifist, but she does it because she knows she has to do it. And all this is all bundled up in a very hectic, packed few months because there is literally an emergency. Even before Noor's training is complete, she has to be sent. So on the night of 16th June, Noor is flown in a Lysander to France. All she's carrying on her is a false passport, a few francs, and a case of pills. One of the pills is a cyanide pill. They land in France. She has to make her way to Paris, where she joins the biggest circuit. The circuit is this intelligence cell that's working there. It's called the Prosper Circuit, and it's led by this man, Francis Suttill. He's a barrister from London. And the other important agent is Franz Anthelm. And Noor is going to work really closely with Franz because within a week of her landing, the circuit is blown. Somebody has informed about them. And Francis and all the others, his own radio operator, his courier, they're all arrested. So Noor, following her training, strict training, she immediately goes underground. So does Franz. London writes to her, to come back. They say, it's very dangerous. Come back, we'll send a flight for you. But Noor says no, because she's determined. She says, I'm the last link left between London and Paris, and I'm going to rebuild the circuit. And she's going to work with Franz Anthelm. So suddenly this gentle, beautiful girl, who was a musician, a dreamer, is transformed into Madeleine, the SOE agent with the Germans, the Gestapo, hot on her heels. She keeps them guessing. They laid traps for her because they know how important she is. And I'm going to tell you very briefly why her work is so dangerous. She is now doing the job of 6 radio operators by herself. You can see this radio set. It's disguised in the form of a suitcase, but it weighs 15 kilos. And Noor has to take this around with her in Paris, so she can be spotted in the metro carrying this, questioned. And if they find this, she'll be arrested straight away. So she has several narrow escapes, talks her way out of situations, but she carries on. It's also really dangerous because when this transmission goes out, the Germans have these listening devices and they can hear where it's coming from. So very quickly they get into that area and they arrest the agent. So her job is to find a place, put up a long aerial, which is about 13 feet without being seen, send this message, make sure it's correct, and then get out from there as fast as you can. So you can imagine the tension, the adrenaline that's running in her as she moves from place to place. She uses all her contacts in Paris, her teacher, music teacher, her friend, her doctor. Suddenly they find that Noor is outside, you know, Babuli, as they call her, is standing outside saying, I have to send a message. And she sends a message and she goes. She dyes her hair red. It looks awful. She changes it back. And so this goes on. She survives for 3 months doing crucial work, whereas most of her colleagues only survived 6 weeks. London is delighted with her. They say, we're going to send you a flight. You've done superb work. Come back now. And she's all ready to go. But this is Paris, occupied Paris is a different world from where Noor grew up. Everywhere there were informers. And Noor is, you know, the news is tightening around her. Noor is going to be betrayed. She is actually betrayed by the sister of one of the agents. And the minute they have her address, who hands her address to the Gestapo for 100,000 francs. And when they have her address, they come into her flat and they arrest her. And they take her to Avenue Foch, which is the Gestapo headquarters. So all the prisoners, this is in a beautiful boulevard in Paris, and all the prisoners are kept in these attic rooms. But Noor makes 2 escape attempts. One is as soon as she's taken in. She's also bitten her captor. She's a fighter. She's not going to just go down and accept her fate. She is going to struggle and try to get out as much as she can. She makes a second escape attempt with 2 other prisoners, but it's unsuccessful. And now the commandant of this place, he says, she's too hot to handle. He picks up the phone, he dials Berlin, and he says, get her out of here. So Noor now becomes the first British agent, woman agent, to be sent to a prison in Germany. She is sent to Forsheim prison in the Black Forest in Germany. And here she is kept for 10 months. She is kept in shackles. So there is a chain passing between her hands. There's a chain passing between her feet, and there is a chain passing between her hands and her feet. So she has to hop everywhere. She can't feed herself, she can't clean herself. She's kept in isolation, she is tortured, she is beaten, she is starved, but she doesn't give up. And she doesn't give away a single secret of her organization, name any colleagues. She puts up with this brutal interrogation for 10 months. And there are eyewitnesses, it's in the book, there are eyewitnesses in the jail who can hear her crying, but she doesn't give up, she keeps her spirits up. And 10 months later, they come to her cell at night and they take her away. She is then taken to another prison, where Karlsruhe prison, where 3 other women agents are brought to this car. And then they are driven to the railway station. They are told that they're going to go to Munich and they are going to work as agricultural laborers. On the train, their handcuffs are taken off. And suddenly for a few minutes, there is this sense of freedom. She suddenly met 3 women agents and they can exchange news. They can talk in English. They're given a picnic lunch. They watch these beautiful Bavarian mountains. And I think for a few hours, they enjoy themselves. You know, it's just a few minutes of peace, but they don't know that the man who is escorting them, Max Wasmer, he is carrying the execution order with him. So it is night by the time they reach the gates of Dachau. And of course, these are the gates of Dachau. Dachau was the first concentration camp. So Auschwitz was based on this construction. And the gates of Dachau have Arbeit, marked Frei, written on them. Arbeit Machtfrei means work will set you free, which was, of course, not happening. Everybody, nobody walked free from Dachau. Now, Noor had, she was labeled as a highly dangerous prisoner. She had made escape attempts. And I think it was either because of that, as well as the fact that she was dark-skinned, she was taken away. She was isolated from the other three women and taken there and beaten and tortured at night. And all night she was kicked, beaten. And when she was just, you know, a pile on the floor, this sadist puts a gun to her head and shoots her point blank. But Noor's spirit, Noor is not broken. She goes down screaming, Liberté. And I think that is her victory because they can't break her spirit. So then Noor is taken away, her body is thrown into the crematorium and eyewitnesses see the smoke from the chimneys, ashes scattered. For her bravery, posthumously, Noor is awarded the George Cross by Britain, which is the highest civilian honor. And France award her the Croix de Guerre, which is their highest civilian honor. This plaque is in the memorial room in Dachau. It says, in France, she was called Madeleine of the Resistance. It says, prisoner in Dachau, Buckmaster Circuit, and of course, George Cross and Croix de Guerre. Now, after, you know, when I started writing Noor's story, she was awarded all these, you know, top honors, but her story was forgotten over the years. And when I started researching, nobody really heard of Noor. It was a forgotten story. And my book was published in 2006. And then I got a lot of letters. These are various editions. The last one you can see is a Marathi translation. That's one of the Indian languages of the books, Spy Princess. I got a lot of letters saying that, you know, how, why didn't we know this story? Somebody said there should be a memorial for Noor. So I thought, okay, you know, it falls on my shoulders. I better do something. So I actually set up a trust, set up and started a campaign. And 2 years later, in 2012, we unveiled, Princess Anne unveiled this memorial for Noor in Gordon Square, which is where she used to live. And if you look in this picture, actually behind those buildings is where Noor used to live when she lived in London. It's a place called Taverton Street. So it's a beautiful memorial. It's visited by people from around the world and everybody puts flowers. They put stones over there. Jewish people put stones. It's beautiful. On Holi, which is an Indian festival, apparently the students, because it's in the student university area, they come and put colors on her. So, but it is part of the Bloomsbury Peace Tour as well. So it's a really beautiful spot. And this started a process, you know, where people were getting to know about her. So Royal Mail contacted me and they wanted a stamp for her centenary. So in 2014, we had a stamp, the first class, of course. And so that was very nice going through people's doors and, you know, getting the story really out there. And last year, I was absolutely delighted because after 16 years of campaigning, I got a blue plaque. Which was, they asked me to unveil. I unveiled this outside her house on 4 Taverton Street, which is in Gordon Square. So now Gordon Square has become a little bit of Noor in there because there's the blue plaque and there is the memorial. And it's lovely that her story is not forgotten. So thank you all for listening. It's been a pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you, Shrabani. We have messages saying that you are a wonderful storyteller. And, I'm not surprised that you have become a best-selling author. And now we're going to hear from Mahmoud, who is the person who was a cousin of Noor's and has personal memories of what she was like. I know that you have a very interesting story about her as a piano teacher. Could you tell us about that, please?
Well, yes, that's a strange kind of story, but at the same time, it's an illustration of Noor's ability in a way to live in two worlds at the same time, which in a sense you don't know her life, because the life in Faisal Menzel, of course, during Inayat Khan's time, but even after his time, was in a very spontaneous way, very Indian. although English was the language, well, that was the case in many families in India as well, but the whole atmosphere, the way of life was really very much Indian. And then she goes to school in a French school. Of course, her whole outer society, her studies, everything is done in France. So there you have that kind of dual emphasis in her life already. And that really, in a way, marks her whole character, her whole mental makeup, living in one world and dreaming of another world. And so that same thing marks her life, also her children's stories, the Jataka tales, which she worked out for children, Buddhist tales, which she worked out for children, and so on. But then, you know, apart from having lived in England, having studied in France, she used to come, every winter she used to come to Holland and stay with friends of us quite nearby. And so she used to come to visit us also. And then at the given moment, my father said, well, look at this little Mahmoud, he really should learn some music. At least he should learn some of the piano. Oh, well, you could teach him some piano lessons. Well, Noor, or Bawuli, as we used to say, was very willing to do that. But of course, she being a very advanced musician herself, she thought she would teach me Mozart's Sonate Facile. Now, anybody who knows the Sonate Facile of Mozart knows that it is not that kind of facile as you might expect for a beginning, a little student who doesn't know anything. So she put that in front of me, not the children's edition, but the classical edition of that famous sonata, and expect me to play it. And you can understand it was all the same a bit hard and a bit embarrassing for me, thinking I came from a family so expert in music and I know nothing. Anyway, I tried it. And in order to stimulate my interest in what I was doing and understand what was going on, she started telling me stories why I was playing. She said, now you see in this note and this passage, it is all the rabbits, all the bunnies running around in the field and frolicking and playing and so on and so on. So she started telling me stories why I was playing that allegro part. She was telling me stories about all the animals of the field and all the bunnies and all the rabbits and everybody who were just dancing and, you know, having a good time. And so then then it came to the andante, then she had more rabbits doing more things in a more quiet way, but it went on like this. So there again, after all, a curious way of being so proficient in music on the one hand herself, and at the same time having this imaginative spirit that she could at the same time combine that with this kind of storytelling, which she thought would be welcome for me to learn it. And of course, then later on, her little sister came, who by then was also a grown-up girl, and she was supposed to give me some lessons. And then when, again, the same famous Sonate Facile came up, she made me play it, and said, but where are the rabbits? And she didn't understand a bit. She never had heard about any rabbits connected with Mozart. So I said, well, you know, this girl is not really a competent music teacher. No, give me more any time.
Well, when you showed us the cover of her book, Shrabani and Mahmoud, did you notice, everybody, that there was a person speaking to a wolf or a dog or some other animal? She seemed to not differentiate so much between animals and people. It's all life. And yes. There's a story in Shrabani's book about the monkeys. Could you just tell us that very briefly? Because I have a couple of other questions. The monkeys that were needed in order to get to the other side of the river.
Yes, Shrabani.
This is for me.
Either of you.
The Sheikh Mahmoud, you go ahead.
You're a much better storyteller, so please do.
Not at all. So yes, this is a story about this monkey king who sacrifices his life so that his monkeys can cross the bridge. And how does he do this? He lies down himself. So he makes himself the bridge, and all the monkeys can escape by lying down on him, and it's and escaping. So he saves his monkeys by sacrificing himself. At the end, by the time the monkeys have gone, he himself dies. The bridge breaks, he dies. But it's really interesting because this story was then picked up by Noor's codemaker and given to her. And, you know, he tried to make Noor feel, because Noor was somebody who didn't want to lie, and he wanted her to focus on her faith as well as her work. And he says, remember the story of Brahmadatta, remember the story of the Monkey King. And when you are sending your messages, remember that every correct message, a monkey is crossing the bridge. And so if you fail, if you make a mistake, a monkey falls off that bridge. And this is something Noor really took with her. And she never made a mistake. Her messages were perfect. And so in the end, she did sacrifice herself, but all her monkeys, you know, they crossed that bridge. I think we had the D-Day landings and took it from there.
Yeah. Right. I think it's an amazing parallel with her own life. Mm-hmm. And some of her trainers really understood how to reach the specificity of this woman when they were training her for the SOE. Mm-hmm. Mahmoud, we were listening to Shrabani, and she told us that the two major elements of Sufism, which is the religion that Noor was trained in or grew up in, had two major elements. She said meditation and music. Could you add to what Shrabani told us? What is Sufism? Is it about dervish dancers? Is it about frenzy?
It's a very international phenomenon. And of course, there's popular Sufism and there is a sophisticated Sufism. Sophisticated in the sense that it had a very rich literature, in particular in Persian. But then, of course, it had a long tradition in the Middle East in which it absorbed all kind of older systems. It is a form of mysticism, school of meditation, etc. But then it came to India. And that transmission of transition to India of that whole Sufi lore, which came from the Middle East with Arabic, and then, of course, found a poetic high watermark in Persia, came to India. And I've sometimes compared that with the phenomenon that you got in Europe with the Renaissance. With the Renaissance, you had a Christian Europe, then you had the Renaissance, but the Renaissance, after that, Europe is still Christian, but it is a very different Europe. And so the same thing with Sufism, which is not a religion, but a mystical tradition, a training of mysticism, which absorbed many different religious elements, came to India. And there, Inayat Khan himself goes on emphasizing this was an Sufism found its completion in India. And as he emphasized it, it had its completion because in India there was a meditative tradition going out for thousands of years. So naturally that gave that a kind of joint kind of experience of these different values into one. And so you'll always say, if you look at religions, if you look at cultures, if you look at civilizations, they will all be different and distinct according to the peoples in which they are functioned. But when you come to the experience of the life of the soul, the experience of mysticism, then all these are identical. Never mind if you follow one system or another, but there, the identity is there. And so that was his conviction. And what about that music? Music for him was the highest form of aesthetic contemplation. If you admire beauty, you become contemplative through the beauty. The most abstract of all aesthetic values is music, because it goes beyond words. It's just a tone, it's just a pure tone. And then Inayat Khan again emphasized that has been a great tradition of India. If you looked at the oldest saints of India, Narada, Tambara, he names different ones, they were great musicians. The musical instruments themselves were invented by the Hindu gods. Shiva of the northern Veena, Saraswati for the southern Veena, Krishna for the flute, etc. So in India, you had that old tradition of linking music with the spiritual life, because music gets you into that kind of aesthetic way of life, which raises you about your purely physical consciousness, even your mental consciousness, into a very intense state of being, living in that beauty, being there and yet transcending your outward being. And so that, of course, leads to that further step in mysticism, where that experience of the soul's life is fully experienced. And so that was his great theme and wonder. And if in India that could be achieved through all these different religions, through the Sufism that came out of Islam, through the Vedanta tradition of the Hindu tradition, if these two great civilizations could unite at that level of aesthetic and mystical experience, why should the Europeans not be added to that as well? And so he developed an Indian mysticism in a European context.
And I think we have a photo, don't we, of a Sufi gathering. Maybe Sheikh Mahmoud, you might tell us a little bit about this photo once we see it.
That's right. That was in Inayat Khan started in Suren, where he lived, giving summer schools. There were three monthly summer schools running from June to September in a large field, which was across from his residence. There was a large grounds. There was a lecture hall, and there he gave the summer schools. And every after his own time, every year, these summer schools continued to be held under the leadership of his brothers. And of course, on the day that of the birthday of Inayat Khan, the 5th of July, there would be a joint photograph of all the participants. Now, on this photograph, which you see here before you, is from 1933. And then you can see there, Babali, that is Nurunissa, seated here with her brother Vilayat next to her, and very proudly sitting at their feet is me. I'm sitting underneath Nurunissa, and my sister Himanissa just sitting next to Vilayat. So that was quite a great event for us to have these great and beautiful cousins of ours, and just we happened to be joined with them in this photograph. So, very touching experience at the time.
That's wonderful.
Can you hear me?
Yes, yes. We hear you, Shalami.
I want to say that picture, somehow I saw it, maybe it was in one of the movies, and it goes on and on and on. There are hundreds of people in that picture. And yes, you can see how popular the teachings were of the Sufi movement there. I love the idea that Sufism is something that people from many different religions can share, but the different religions also have their differences. For example, when I think of mysticism as a Jewish person, I think of Kabbalah. Yeah. And I don't believe that Kabbalah, and correct me people if I am wrong, that Kabbalah has a musical tradition of the same thing. So I think Sufism is not only a combination of everything, but adds other elements.
That's why we're so happy to say that it's Indian Sufism, because in India, music has always been the highest of the arts, precisely because it was the most abstract of the arts. And therefore being most abstract leads you most readily to the life of the soul.
And you don't need anything to hear music, different from art, for example. My father was hiding in Holland during the Holocaust, and in order to keep his sanity, he remembered music and remembered the phrasing and the movements and all the aspects of it. It really sustained his soul. So I want to make sure that we have touched what you think are the important elements of Sufism. I think you gave a really excellent explanation of it, and there's much more to learn. And is there anything else you wanted to add?
Shula, I want to add one thing. So Hazrat Inayat Khan started this practice of, we're talking about being inclusive of all religions. So he started this practice of universal worship. So every night, in these Sufi gatherings, and every night, even when there wasn't a Sufi gathering, he would light a candle to each faith, and 11 candles would be put up. And then they would have the music. So it was always every day, there was this consciousness that we are all one, whatever religions we are, So his followers were Christians, they were Jews, they were Buddhists. And even now the tradition that continues is, they're from all faiths, whatever their faith is, they're Sufis from different faiths, which is really beautiful.
It is.
So just wanted to explain that, yeah.
One person has asked a question already, which is, if Sufism embraces people from so many faiths, was that an element in her parents' rejecting of Mr. Goldberg as Noor's partner, or was it only that he was a domineering person?
Well, you see, I must say that's one thing of the pre-war world and the pre-war, which today it would be very hard to understand. But before the war in Europe, it was a very class-conscious society. And the leader, or the vast majority of people who joined Sufism were leisured class. And so the leisured class felt itself to be an upper class. And so it was really a class distinction more than anything else, which caused the difficulty. That you had to be, had a certain aristocratic way about you, you had to have a certain style of breeding, a certain style of behaviors, all these kind of things. And so in general, it was felt by the family that, yeah, Goldenberg was a very nice man. I remember him very well.
Really?
Yes, yes, a very nice man. Uh-huh. But unfortunately, he did not belong to that particular group of people who felt themselves, not only in relation to him, but in relation to all kind of comers to the Sufi movement who did not really belong to that particular group. I mean, again, it is a mentality long gone. It's no longer characteristic of any kind of Sufi group today. But in the pre-war Sufi group, it was definitely an aristocratic society, a leisure class society. And if you didn't belong to that, you had better keep out of it. You see, that was the main. Otherwise, he was a very nice looking man. He looked a bit oriental, of course, amongst all the Europeans. He was from Romania. And he had a kind of Turkish kind of culture. So yes, in every other way, he was really quite, well, if you say domineering, can you imagine someone from the patriarch from the Balkans not being domineering? Well, of course. But when you have an American mother, that might be a bit of a problem, probably, I don't know. But that was not really the thing. The thing was really that the family thought that vis-a-vis their own leaders and representatives and leading followers, as we call them, because they were really leading followers, they simply could not afford that newness to that kind of marriage.
You have taught me two new things. One is that Sufism varied among the countries in which it was adopted. And another one is that Sufism has changed over time. So there's a fluidity in this religion as well, rather than a strict dogma.
Well, if you have dogma, you're mysticism.
And maybe because Olivia and I were thinking, why did, of all the things that Noor could have said when she was about to be killed, she said liberté, she could have said anything. She could have said vérité, truth, because, you know, or she could have said, égalité, or whatever it is. But why did she say liberté? And I think that's because now that I learn more, it has to do with the convictions that Sufism allows people to have through meditation, which is certainly you can't control another person's meditation.
No, that's right.
So the assertion of the self,
yes,
within this set of beliefs. It's really remarkable.
It's very Indian to call spiritual fulfillment and the perfection of the personality by consciously involving his soul in his life as a person, that, and that is of course the Indian fulfillment of soul type, is you call moksha, mukti, the freedom of the soul, the freedom of the inner being. Mm-hmm. And so that was very much in his mind. The first book of Inayat Khan is called like that, Sufi Message of Spiritual Liberty. So there he has the Sufi term, he has the Vedantic term. Another thing was that when he came, maybe I should still add that, when he came to Europe, to the West, it was not to propagate Sufism. Later, his followers started saying, yes, he was sent to the West because, you know, his Muslim wanted him to spread Sufism, nothing of the kind. He was there to, first mysticism for him was a fulfillment of music. So he wanted to demonstrate that the Europeans, the Westerners bring so many useful things to India, but we have a great Indian culture ourselves. And the greatest of Indian cultures is indeed music. So we want to tell the West what a wonderful kind of great advanced art and music we have. But then, of course, speaking about music, you also spoke about the mystical dimension, about the Sufi dimension of music. And so once he gave two concerts at the Hindu temple in America, in California. And so, of course, they were very enthusiastic about the music. But the American audience, they said, one of the people in the audience, he said, well, all right, that music is okay. We don't really understand. It was nice. You read people are nice people and they did a good job. But we do not really understand it. You might like to learn it. But what you said about the spiritual dimension of it, that we like very much. can't we learn from him? And so gradually, really gradually, and quite unexpectedly, because they were going to make a musical tour the rest of 2 years or 3 years. But then suddenly, that spiritual dimension connected with music suddenly gained people's interest. And so then gradually, they shifted more and more from, at least in Uitgang, shifted more and more from music plus a mystical dimension to a mystical dimension plus music.
I understand. So, you have to modify your message when you are trying to reach people.
Yes.
Now, I will modify who's speaking. We will go to Olivia, who will tell us about what's coming up next. I don't think anything will be as good as this, of course.
I actually have a question before we go to coming attractions.
Of course.
And that has to do with a story about Noor that was not in the film. So Shrabani, I'm wondering if you can tell that story. And that has to do with the question of her loyalty as, well, what is her loyalty? At that point, India was still under British rule as the future state of Israel was also under British rule at the time. They both got their independence at the same moment, 1948, from the British. So to an Indian woman, as to a Jewish person, the British were our friends and our enemies at different times. Can you tell that anecdote, please, about Noor?
So yes, as I said before, Noor was descended from Tipu Sultan. And Tipu Sultan is the ruler of 18th century ruler of Mysore in South India. And he actually died on the battlefield fighting the British. So that is the family history. And her father, who was very much, you know, who believed in Indian freedom, he was quite proud. I mean, I think the word nationalist is not looked, you know, is frowned upon now. It's not politically correct, but he was somebody who believed in freedom. So he was a freedom fighter. He wanted independence. And he would tell his children, that is Noor and Vilayat, that you have the blood of Tipu Sultan in your veins. And that made them feel really strong, you know, that there was a fighter in them as well. So Noor, when she's growing up, now her father had met Gandhi. He sang songs for Gandhi during the First World War. And the British had noticed him. So, you know, they were a little suspicious of her father. But Noor grew up, she was very conscious of what is happening in India. So when the war starts, the Second World War, in 1942, Gandhi calls the Quit India movement. And all the top political leaders, so Gandhi, Nehru, they're all put in jail. And they stay in jail for the whole duration of the war. So the time that Noor is entering the SOE, and she's having these crucial interviews, is the time when the Indian political leadership is all in prison. And she's very conscious of Indian independence. She believes firmly in it herself. She then is called for an interview by the RAF. And it's really interesting because they ask her, they say, where do your loyalties lie? Are you going to be loyal to the British or are you going to be loyal to India? And she says, she's very clear. She's so focused at such a young age. She says, at this time when the war is on, the priority is to win this war. And when the war is over, I will support Indian independence. And saying this to a board of RAF officers who are interviewing her, their jaw dropped. And she was actually really angry. She came home. I mean, I've been told this story by her brother Vilayat, who said she came home and she was so angry. She said, I lost my temper because they questioned my loyalty. Obviously, I am going to support them at this stage. Her younger brother Hidayat said that if Noor had survived the war, after that, her next mission would have been Indian independence. So maybe Shula, in answer to your question about why Liberté, I think freedom was something also very important to her. It was freedom for France from, you know, German occupation. It was freedom for India from British occupation. She did dream that one day India would be free. She never saw, you know, never lived to see India get independence in 1947. That would have been something that, you know, she would have been very proud of. In fact, she also believed that if Indians sacrificed in the war, the British would reward them for their loyalty and give them independence. So that was also some of the thinking that she had when she signed up for this war effort. So there's a lot going on in her mind. And all these divided loyalties, there's Sufism, which is telling her to be nonviolent. there's India, Britain, but she's very focused. She knows that winning this war is important.
Maybe we don't have to say divided loyalties, because that sounds like you are not faithful to some of them, but mm-hmm. maybe multiple loyalties.
Perfect, yes.
Though, before I talk about upcoming programs, let me just remind everybody that we do have copies of Shrabani Basu's book, Spy Princess, for sale. And we have just a few copies left, so I would urge you to get your copy as soon as you can. You will receive an email today after the program telling you how to order the book and also about how to sign up for our upcoming programs. Most of our programs are free. Next week, we do have a paid program, but it's tickets by donation, donations of any amount. We do recommend the amount of $18, which represents life or high. But if you can give more, please do. If that's not comfortable for you, give whatever is comfortable for you. The paid programs do support our free programs for the rest of the month. So next week's program is about the composer Felix Mendelssohn, who in the 19th century, he was a 19th century figure. He was the grandson of the great Jewish theologian Moses Mendelssohn. Felix himself was taken for conversion by his parents to be converted to Lutheranism. So he grew up as a Lutheran child, but cognizant of very deep Jewish roots. And his music reflects both the Lutheran tradition of Bach and others, and also the Jewish cantorial tradition. He marries that in his music. So that was the case of Mendelssohn in the 19th century. Fast forward 100 years to the period of the Nazi occupation, and the Nazis then declared Mendelssohn's music to be quote unquote Jewish music. They banned his music from being played, and they reclassified Mendelssohn's descendants as Jewish instead of whatever they happened to be by the time the 1940s came around. So they were persecuted as Jews. One of these descendants is the filmmaker Sheila Heyman, who is British. She was born in England of a father who was a German Jewish refugee boy who went to England. And so she made this glorious film called Mendelssohn, the Nazis, and Me. And we're going to show you a trailer to entice you to sign up for next week's program.
Felix Mendelssohn's Wedding March may be the best known tune in the world. Until 1934, it blessed marriages all over Germany. But under the Nazis, playing any piece of Mendelssohn could cost you your life.
I was 10 years old and my piano teacher gave me Mendelssohn's Lieder ohne Worte, and she told me, if you practice it, please close your window because the music is forbidden.
This film is about what happened to Mendelssohn's music when the Nazis came to power and why Felix, the German national treasure, was also a Jew.
They had the idea that the German nation was an organism which needed to be cured. They wanted to use science to define who a Jew was.
Do you have Jewish earlobes?
I'm not sure. I don't think anyone's ever looked at my earlobes with sufficient attention.
The Nazis tried to define in which case the persons of a marriage could come out Jews or not, and the children of them, Jews or not.
It's also the story of what happened to his family at that time.
It dawned on us gradually that the Jews were really dreadful people, but only slowly that, in some sense, I was one of them.
His less Jewish cousins, who remained in Germany, no longer had any idea who they were.
All of a sudden, I was not German any longer. I didn't belong to anything and anybody. And for a young person, it's very, very hard.
To himself, Felix may have been a religious mongrel like the rest of the family. To the Nazis, he was unquestionably a Jew. The fate of his music now became entwined with that of the whole Jewish population of Germany. And when the Jews were sent to the camps, they took Mendelssohn with them. This propaganda film begins with Elijah. It was the last music many of them heard before they were transported to Auschwitz. I'm Sheila Heyman, a filmmaker, and I want to find out why Mendelssohn was so important to the Nazis and why the family found themselves caught up in a forgotten crisis of identity that began with Felix himself. Because that family is also mine. Felix Mendelssohn was my great-great-great-great uncle.
So I hope you will sign up for that program and the programs to come. So now let's turn back to our panel of speakers for their final thoughts, starting with Sheikh Al-Masheikh Mahmoud Khan Yuskin.
Well, I think, of course, for me, it is a matter of great gratification that Noor's heroism is acknowledged to the extent it has been, and especially Shrabani has really did everything to secure her memory. And that's one thing I deeply appreciate indeed. It is, for us, of course, it was a terrible thing when we first heard about Noor Anissa being lost. Immediately after the liberation of Holland, Pierre Villard came up, her brother, on his way to Germany to get inquiries about her, because nothing was known about her at that time. And so our joy at last being rid of the Nazi domination, of course, the joy was marred by this sudden uncertainty about what might have happened to Noor. And the fact it was a terrible tragedy, of course, to learn what happened to her when at last the details became known. But that those now, her memory is now enshrined in the work of Shrabani Basu really is for us a matter of deep, deep gratitude and gratification. So once again, Shrabani, thank you so very much for this wonderful work you have been doing on behalf of all of us. Thank you so very much indeed.
Shrabani, what would you like to say to our audience?
Oh, well, that was lovely. Thank you so much for inviting me. And, you know, I'm so moved by this film you showed me just now on Mendelssohn. So look forward to seeing more programs. I want to thank Sheikh Masheikh, I call him Sheikh Mahmoud, for all the help he gave me while I wrote the book, because his stories are in my book as well. So thank you for the help all those years ago when I was researching this book and I, you know, had no idea where I was going with it. I think Noor's story, it is tragic, but I think what I take away and what I think people, I hope, take away from it is how inspiring she is. So I think the hope and the faith and the courage is what we all take away from her book. It is
what you also added to your book is the memory of all the Indians, the numbers of Indians, and which we are also remembered, and we decorate in one way or another way. Yeah. For their bravery was rewarded, etc., etc., etc. So I think that's a very important contribution to your book as well. How many Indians really fought for the liberation in the World War, and very happy you listed them as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
Shulamit, 2.5. Shulamit, what are your final thoughts?
Well, I feel like a whole world has opened up to me that I want to learn all about. There is nothing that I heard about Sufism that I disagree with. So that is one of my final thoughts. The other thing I wanted to reiterate that Shrabani told us about is that the danger of the specific job that Noor had, it was dangerous for everyone to be a spy or to go behind enemy lines, et cetera. But being a radio operator was probably the most dangerous of all. And the parallel story, in a way, in Israeli history is the story of Eli Cohen, who went to spy on Iraq. And what he found there was he could do everything, in Syria, I meant, not Iraq. He could do everything to find out all sorts of information, taking risks all the time. But what was he caught for after being there for so many years was for being a Morse code transmitter, because they had these trucks that went around looking for where the signal was, which you talked about, Shrabani, and it gave you away. So it was like going to another country to be a spy and advertising yourself. And she knew it. And she was willing to take the risk because she knew how important it was to liberate Europe and the world from Nazism.
So thank you, Shulamit, for moderating today's program. My deepest thanks to author Shrabani Basu and Sheikh Al-Masheikh Mahmoud Khan Yuskin. I'll get it right. And thank you to our loyal audience that comes week after week. Please join us again next week and the weeks to come.